Welcome to the panel presented by Coventry Homes. Tony Barr here alongside a pair of voices of the Edmonton Oilers, Jack Michaels and Bob Stauffer. We recap the 2021 season that was in Edmonton as we find ourselves in another beautiful show home, this time in the community of Greasebaugh. This popular model is called the Sculptor. At nearly 3,000 square feet, this spacious home includes three bedrooms, each with their own private ensuite, a main floor den, bonus room, and a fully finished basement. This home also features two lifestyle packages, the executive chef kitchen and the entertainer home theater option. You can tour the home yourself or take a virtual tour located on the website. But gentlemen, as we come out of that great showing of this show home, we go to a less than ideal result on the ice for the Oilers. Bob, what were some of the takeaways for you out of this series? Why wasn't Edmonton able to manufacture a win against the Jets?
Well, I know when we did our preview of the series, Tony, both Jack and myself, you know, we knew that Winnipeg had a pretty good team. They had a Vezina Trophy caliber goaltender. The question was, when were they going to get some of their bodies back to add a little bit of depth up front? Connor Hellebuck gave Winnipeg a 950 save percentage. And frankly, we've seen deeper teams than Edmonton. Think Pittsburgh back in 2012-13, that lockout year when the Penguins came in first in the East, had the best power play in the East, led the NHL in goals that year. That was a really deep team. They scored two goals in four games against Tuukka Rask that year. So, you know, in hockey, the goaltender is the great equalizer. Pat Burns, you know, 70% of hockey is goaltending. Unless you don't have it, it's 100%. Well, Winnipeg had it, and at 100% made a difference. Oilers got good goaltending from Mike Smith. Connor Hellebuck was fantastic. Winnipeg's depth scoring came through. I didn't mind Edmonton's game. I think they played better in this series than they did last year against the Chicago Blackhawks. It's disappointing for everybody. But I think at the end of the day, Winnipeg was just a little bit better and a little bit deeper. And those sort of things happen. It wasn't really a four-game series. And when we come to evaluate the year that was, I think we have to factor in what occurred during the regular season. But I know Jack's going to have some of his own thoughts on the series as well.
Well, Tony, when I look at it, a couple of things that held up in the regular season did not hold up in the postseason. I mean, all year long, Edmonton had been a dominant team, the best team in the National Hockey League when it scored the first goal. Twice in this series, scored the first goal, unable to come up with a victory. All year long, Edmonton's one loss in the regular season when leading after two periods was against the Winnipeg Jets. Well, they had two of them in the postseason. So a few things didn't hold up for Edmonton in terms of the way the general flow of the game went. But you look at the series and you start trying to figure out what happened. I mean, Edmonton led for 60 minutes. Winnipeg didn't even lead for 20. But it was the last goal that always seemed to belong to the Jets. It was the timely goal that seemed to belong to the Jets. And over the course of the series, what I was most impressed with, in addition to Connor Hellebuck, because again, I didn't think the gap was as big between Hellebuck and Smith. For me, the gap was my expectation of what Winnipeg's defense would be able to do against Edmonton's top players. That defense held up much better than I thought it did. Full marks to the Jets. They got contributions from guys I did not anticipate. Guys like Tucker Pullman with a timely goal. Logan Stanley held up. They didn't get exposed. That was a big difference for me because I thought Edmonton had a decided advantage in that area.
And the way the defense stepped up for Winnipeg was really reminiscent of the way the Chicago defense stepped up last season in the play-in series. But Jack, we heard from the players in their exit interviews earlier this week on Tuesday. Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl said they want to win and they want to win here. So we also heard from general manager Ken Holland. I ask you, with the flat cap, how is the market challenging this Oilers general manager, particularly with their top three UFAs in Larson, Nugent Hopkins, and Smith?
Well, first of all, I've never really understood why it's a storyline that Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl have to repeat themselves over and over, go that they want to win and they want to win here. They wouldn't have signed long-term contracts if they didn't want to win and win here. I think that's a narrative sometimes pushed by our neighbors to the east, quite frankly. It's never been a storyline here in the city of Edmonton.
So how about winning immediately, though?
Well, winning immediately, I think, number one, it is a process. You've got to be around it. This is the second straight year the Oilers had been in postseason play, whatever round you want to call it or whatever. But it had been nearly 20 years since Edmonton had accomplished that feat. So the Oilers have done that. Now they're going to need a third and maybe a fourth and maybe a fifth and sixth crack at it. I mean, you don't have to look too far to find out clubs that needed several chances before they finally claim the Stanley Cup. Certainly our three most recent champions, Tampa, St. Louis, and Washington, would all fit into that category. Edmonton has not been around it as long as those teams have.
And just to chime in there, Jack, also with the Pittsburgh Penguins in 2007, when they got ousted by Ottawa, 4-1 series, they came back and made back-to-back Stanley Cup finals.
Well, I think actually even a greater example of that would be the second set of champions the Penguins had. I mean, they were around it, as Bob mentioned, the 13 team. They had some disappointing first-round losses, didn't get good goaltending in some of those matchups. I mean, people forget. They went 7 years between Crosby's first and second cup. So, you know, again, that be that as it may, here and now for Edmonton, they've got some decisions to make. We heard that Ken Holland is going to have a few buyouts potentially on the table. They have to decide, are they going to roll with the goaltending tandem of Smith and Koskinen for a second consecutive year? I quite frankly believe they will. And then, obviously, major decisions on Larson, Nugent Hopkins, Barry. What's the future of Oscar Klefbom? These are all things that are going to shake themselves out in the next 6 weeks and give Ken Holland a clearer picture of what he actually has to deal with as it relates to the flat cap that you alluded to.
So, Bob, what are some of the other priorities for
Holland? First of all, you know, we're sitting here in, a house, Coventry Homes. One of the things that makes a great house is you got to have a great base. And I think when you think of the Edmonton Oilers, the advantage that they have is with the emergence this year of Darnell Nurse as a legitimate top-pairing NHL defenseman. I might suggest there's only 15, you know, number one defensemen in the NHL. He became one. They're going to have to factor in his contract in a year from now because he's going to get paid because he's earned it and he's taken two straight bridge deals. That has to be factored in along with Jesse Puljujärvi, who came on during the second half of the year. Those guys are only in at $6.8 million combined for this upcoming season. They might cost a combined $12 million in a couple of years from now. So I think you have to think a year ahead.
The Yamamoto as well.
Yeah, that one's going to be a little lighter. But okay. What I would say is the Oilers have McDavid, Draisaitl, Nurse. That is an incredible base to come from. I mean, those guys work hard. They're driven. They're committed. And because of it, all of the players that come after them, specifically that come after them, that's the standard that they got to reach, you know, get to. So Bouchard.
Bouchard,
Broberg, McLeod, potentially Holloway down. I would include Puljujärvi and Yamamoto. I mean, Puljujärvi looked like a completely different player this year. I think the agency played a factor. I think Ken Holland's maturity as a general manager played a factor in the Oilers not, frankly, squandering that asset. So I think because you have that base of those top three guys, and because you do have some organic growth coming, which I think has a chance to be maybe better because you do have that standard, I think that bodes well. Now, into the contracts. Mike Smith's going to get re-signed. I respectfully disagree with my partner. I think we're going to see a different goaltending tandem next year. I think there will be some creativity deployed in order to change the complexion of the goaltending around a little bit. On defense, I think Adam Larson's getting re-signed. I think Tyson Barrie will decide whether or not he gets re-signed. I do think that Tyson potentially could get more in the open market than he could in Edmonton. And if he does ultimately end up back at Edmonton, we may see another move subsequently made. But Bouchard's going to play next year for sure. And then up front, Nugent Hopkins for me is going to be the really interesting one. I think this is a deal that at the end of the day, Ryan Nugent Hopkins' camp represented by Rick Vallette and Ken Holland with the Oilers, they might both be a little unhappy with if it ultimately gets done. I'd love to see Ryan back. I think he touches every aspect of the game. Jack, I really liked his comments. He talked about the fact that he needed to improve on a couple things, including his skating and his shot to be a better player. And I liked hearing that from him because it's a recognition that he didn't achieve at the level that he thought he could. That said, he's a very useful player. I think Edmonton's in a good spot. They maybe don't have to completely spend all the money this upcoming summer because it might allow them to add a little bit of wiggle room for during the course of the season. But the organic growth of some of their younger players will complement whatever additions they do ultimately bring in. They're definitely going to add at least one left. Whether or not Nugent Hopkins comes back or not, On top of that, they'll be adding another left wing to help support the top six.
Jack, Bob just mentioned Evan Bouchard amidst all of that. And he said that Bouchard, he expects, will play on a full-time deployment for head coach Dave Tippett next season. So he was one of the guys I wanted to talk to you about, the other being Philip Broberg. What's a realistic expectation for Broberg and maybe a guy like Holloway heading into 2021-2022?
Well, I think Dylan Holloway is going to be given every opportunity to make the hockey club. I think Dylan Holloway might be ready to contribute as soon as next season. I also think Evan Bouchard is, you know, as close to a lock as you can imagine in terms of being in the Edmonton lineup. Now, that may mean that someone moves out, especially if Adam Larson is re-signed, because then you start looking, okay, well, where are the spots then? Now, if Tyson Barrie leaves, you know, and I tend to agree with Bob, I think he could get more money on the open market, then you've got a nice little spot for him opened up. And maybe your three right defense are pretty much laid out in terms of, you know, Bear joining Bouchard. And of course, you know, as we've talked about, I think Adam Larson is a fixture for this club. I really do. I think he's going to re-sign in Edmonton, and I would put him in terms of a bit of a staple and a different type of player than Darnell Nurse as absolutely, you know, part of the core of this club, part of the guts of this club moving forward. Broberg is going to have to push his way in. And part of, you know, what Philip Broberg will have to do is develop the kind of consistent play night in, night out that evidently Dave Tippett didn't see enough of with Caleb Jones. So that'll be, you know, all this is going to shake itself out in training camp in the first 20 games. The good thing is there's going to be lots of competition. And there is, for a second consecutive year, general disagreement between how this club is going to shake up, and that's indicative of competition. There have been years where Bob and I have sat here at this time and been able to pick next year's team. I don't think you can do that with this club. Bob's talking about being creative with goaltending. One of the challenges Edmonton's going to have to figure out is what they want to do with Stuart Skinner. Do they want him to play 50 games next year? If they do, then I don't know whether Mikko Koskinen being in Bakersfield is a realistic option.
Well, and the other option is potentially trade, and the goaltender you could maybe acquire getting back. We'll have to wait and see on that. Just in terms of the young guys, I've got Broberg basically spending the first minimum two-thirds of the season in the American Hockey League next year. He's going to run the power play. He's going to play in every situation, a lot like Bouchard did a couple years ago, and Bouchard really took off in the second half.
And the way Bouchard would have this year, right? In a normal year?
He probably would have started the year in the minors this year, and he might have finished the year in Edmonton. In terms of Holloway, I actually think Holloway is going to start in the minors. I think they're going to have enough, maybe a couple free agent signings on the left side. And again, Holloway is going to play first unit power play, penalty kill, all those situations. But I think he's going to be up sooner than Philip Broberg. Bouchard and McLeod are on the team. The only question is McLeod, you know, do they spend for a third line center? Or do they get a veteran sort of right shot fourth line center at a cheaper rate that can insulate McLeod because they go with McDavid and Draisaitl and theoretically maybe Nugent Hopkins as center options at some point? The bottom line is this. Fans can be upset. They can be frustrated that the team didn't achieve come playoff time. But the reality of the situation is for 2 years, Edmonton's been a 12th and 11th place team overall, Tony. And I think next year we will see Edmonton take a progressive step and become a legitimate top eight team. They were top 11 in the NHL in goals for, goals against, number one in power play, number nine in PK, number seven in save percentage. They had a pretty good year in a lot of different areas. There's been real progression and growth, and I think we'll see another step take place next
Lots
year.
Lots to look forward to for sure. Jack, Bob, always appreciate you guys as we wrap up our third season together on the panel. Does it feel like 3 years yet?
Well, this last year, I think, has felt like 3 years for everyone.
Yeah, of course.
The biggest thing and the biggest takeaway from this season is a second consecutive trip to the postseason. There's pain along the way.
Right.
Seven losses in eight playoff games aren't going to make anyone, least of all the players, feel good, but it also pushes you forward. And again, I go back to what we talked about at the beginning of this panel is – there's very few examples of championship clubs that don't have playoff disappointments along the way.
Of course, Jack, Bob, great job this year on both Sportsnet and 630 Ched all year long. For one final time this season, I'm Tony Barr signing off for the panel presented by Coventry Homes.